立法會主席.
The President. Good morning, we shall continue on question 5. Dr. CHENG Chung-tai. Good morning. I'd like to quote a figure. Well, for the Korean vaccine incident, there are a total of 12.5 million people being vaccinated. As of yesterday, the latest death toll is 100, which is almost close to 1%. In Hong Kong, in a typo kindergarten, we have heard a case in which there's children vaccinated. They know that the vaccine from this company, another supplier, and requests to switch another supplier. However, it was found that the same Sanofi vaccine was injected anyway. That made the parents worried, and the Department of Health yet cannot help these worried parents. May I ask the secretary? So for this major incident in South Korea, what mechanism had Hong Kong in place? I'm not asking how you assure the safety, as been raised by other members already. Well, if we have the same case of the type we can have gotten, how can the parents get the government's help? Or do they wait for their children but now came across any adverse reaction and seek help in the AME department and hospitals and offer help individually? Secretary, the Department of Health have been very concerned about the vaccine incidents in other countries. Well, in Hong Kong, we have the registration system and Department of Health for vaccines in terms of their safety and their efficacy and the quality. And also based on the information provided by the manufacturer and the health authorities of the manufacturing country. Besides, the Department of Health have been working with WHO and the vaccine supplier and with health authorities in those countries in question have been maintaining communication and obtain that information. And locally, we have the mechanism in place for any adverse reaction. We also receive reports. And currently, we have yet to receive any reports of those 600,000 shots already administered. And second, whether from the WHO information or from the Korea or from Taiwan or from other jurisdictions, he has suspended the vaccination. For example, Malaysia and Singapore has since resumed using this vaccine. Most importantly, Department of Health had assured that this batch of vaccine in question not get shipped to Hong Kong, so that we are closely monitoring the situation. And according to Dr. Chang, for the public, if they have any queries or we seek clarification, the Department of Health should step as public education so that they can get the latest information. Dr. LO Wai-kwok, well, the Secretary did ask me a question. Have the Department of Health any contingency mechanism in dealing with the vaccine? Yes, it's in place. The Department of Health had this mechanism in place to deal with any potential defective vaccines, which they would handle accordingly. Dr. LO Wai-kwok, President, quite a number of schools, including secondary, primary, in schools and kindergartens, have an outbreak of upper respiratory tract infection. so that we have the coronavirus in the backdrop and the flu season is coming, a lot of parents have been worried and also disturbed, and they probably couldn't tell apart their symptoms and how to prevent them. Some parents said for the upper respiratory tract retraction preventable, and whether our flu vaccine can prevent this kind of infections. I hope the secretary can clarify. And yesterday, the Department of Health on their 4:30 press conference reported that as a whole, in the kindergarten and primary schools, well, mostly kindergarten and child centers, mainly, that there was an outbreak of respiratory symptoms. These symptoms are different from flu symptoms. The upper respiratory symptom mainly coughing and sneezing, but not necessarily have a fever. We're still very concerned though, when the school reopens, or very often when children take off their masks for meals, they also carry an infection risk. And we still have some carriers in our community that would also have the inherent infection risk. Therefore, we are closely monitoring how this will unfold. And for Department of Health, if some of the school reported an outbreak, we shall immediately arrange testing for the students and the staff. And we have a large number of cases that will suspend the classes for a few days. But currently, we are considering whether we need to have a class suspension of a bigger scale if this outbreak continues. Even though it's upper respiratory infection, we're still quite concerned. And once we had a decision, we will announce immediately. Thank you, President. Which part have been answered? I've asked a specific question. As the parents said that whether the flu vaccine is helpful in preventing the upper respiratory infection. Well, the flu vaccine would definitely would generate antibodies for those inoculated. Well, we need to match the for the symptoms of the flu and the upper respiratory infection are similar to a certain extent. However, the latter is less severe and necessarily having fever. Mr. Holden Chow. President, well, currently there is a shortage of flu vaccine, and then abroad we have this Korean vaccine incidence. Well, in the main reply, it was mentioned that it's estimated by mid to late November there will be a new batch of 85,000 vaccines coming to Hong Kong. And how could the DH properly supervise this batch, and how you handle this batch of shipment? Because a lot of the parents are worried that if some of the batches are defective or related to this incidence, that will be a great cause of concern. I hope you can elaborate on the upcoming shipment. In my main reply, the Department of Health in mid to late November, there will be around 85,000 doses arriving in Hong Kong. And these vaccines are to supply the private healthcare sector. So they're not procured by the government. As we understand, this 85,000 dose will be arriving in Hong Kong. So that would alleviate the shortage in the private sector. Of course, some doctors had ordered but yet to receive the orders, so that is the shipment they should be expecting. Besides, I think over 8.5 million doses already received. We also received 100,000 doses for those who the private doctors who took part in our vaccination programs for the selected high-risk groups.
Last question seeking an oral reply, as Professor Joseph Lee, who raises question, is not here. In accordance with the rules of procedure, I ask Ms. Starry Lee to put the question on his behalf.
起本年初呼籲會員由2月3日至7日罷工, 直至
It's been reported that early this year, the Hospital Authority Employees Alliance, HAEA, called on its members to go on strike from the 3rd to 7th of February in an attempt to press the Hospital Authority, HA, to put forward to the government the demand for implementing border closing measures so as to prevent persons infected with coronavirus disease 2019 from entering Hong Kong via the mainland, spreading the epidemic in the community and causing an outbreak. Early last month, the Human Resources Division of HA sent emails to those healthcare staff it believed to be have been absent from duty, seeking their explanations or clarifications on their absence from duty. In this connection, will the government inform this council, one, whether it knows the number of staff members to whom HA sent emails to seek their explanations or clarifications on their absence from duty, with a breakdown by the grade to which they belong, but the number of staff members from whom HA received replies when the reply deadline expired on the 24th of last month, with a breakdown by the contents of their replies and the grade to which they belonged, the expenditure incurred so far by HA for seeking legal advice on related matters. Two, as some HA staff members have indicated that they had not participated in the strike, but they still received the emails, whether it knows the number of them, with a breakdown by the grade to which they belonged, and why HA sent them the emails. And three, as HA has stated that the staff members' action was an absence from duty, while HAEA has stated that such an action was a lawful industrial action initiated by a trade union formally registered under Section 5 of the Trade Unions Ordinance and protected by law, whether the government will intervene in the hope that the dispute will be resolved expeditiously, if so, of the details, if not the reasons for that. Secretary for Food and Health. Mr. President, the government and the hospital authority always take the safeguarding of public health as the top priority. The healthcare profession always gives prime consideration to patients' health, and no other factors should be allowed to affect its duties and the patients. This has all along been the professionalism and ethics of the healthcare profession and the expectation of society and the general public for the healthcare professionals. The dedication of healthcare professionals is a cornerstone of the effective operation of the public healthcare system. During the 3rd and the 7th of February this year, the industrial action of a certain HA staff was not in the interest of patients and severely affected the public hospital services. For example, all hospital clusters under the HA had to reduce elective surgeries by 50% and quotas for patients with episodic illnesses in general outpatient clinics, GOPCs, by 25%, reschedule follow-up appointments of chronic patients and curtail physiotherapy and occupational therapy outpatient services by about 50%. Services, including the neonatal intensive care units, high dependency units, cardiothoracic surgery, isolation wards, emergency medicine ward, certain cancer services, including chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and cancer surgery, and percutaneous coronary intervention procedures were affected or delayed in different extent due to the lack of manpower. As an employer, the HA has put in place established mechanism, human resources regulations, and code of conduct to regulate and manage issues in relation to the conduct and discipline of staff. If there is violation of the code of conduct and all human resources regulations, the HA will take a very serious and prudent approach in following up on the matter in accordance with the relevant human resources regulations and legal advice, and handle it in a fair and just manner according to the established mechanism. In consultation with the HA, my consolidated reply to Professor Joseph Lee's question is as follows. It came to the HA's attention earlier this year that a staff union had initiated industrial action. In this connection, on the 2nd of February, the HA called on healthcare staff to stay on duty and take the safeguarding of Hong Kong people's health as the top priority while joining hands with the HA to fight the epidemic. The HA reiterated that the industrial action would directly affect public hospital services, which was not in the interest of patients. On the same day, the HA convened the Central Command Committee to review the services and manpower situation in various hospital clusters. Upon evaluation, all hospital clusters needed to significantly adjust services to focus their manpower on maintaining emergency and essential services, including tackling the epidemic. The HA also arranged drug refill services for follow-up patients of specialist outpatient clinics or SOPCs who were in stable conditions so as to focus manpower on providing inpatient services and treating patients attending first appointment at SOPCs. Furthermore, GOPCs managed to maintain all clinics open by such measures as rearranging duty rosters and hiring part-time staff, but follow-up appointments were rescheduled due to the reduced service capacity. In response to the absence from duty by healthcare staff from the 3rd to 7th of February this year, the HA head office and hospital clusters activated the major incident control centers to closely monitor the operation of public hospitals and to deploy manpower and adjust non-emergency services with regard to service needs, with a view to focusing resources on dealing with the epidemic and maintaining emergency medical services. Meanwhile, the government and the HA repeatedly urged healthcare staff participating in the industrial action to return to work as soon as possible to avoid affecting public hospital services and treatment of patients. The HA noted that around 7,000 staff had not reported duty as scheduled on various days from the 3rd to 7th of February this year. In early October, the HA sent letters to the staff members concerned, requesting for their verification of the days of absence as stated in the letter and explanation on their absence from duty. We understand that the replies are being processed by the HA and the breakdown by staff grade and the reasons stated in their replies are not yet available. The HA will follow up the matter in accordance with legal advice and relevant human resources regulations in a fair, reasonable, rational and lawful manner. In the fight against the coronavirus 2019 epidemic, the government and the HA are committed to protecting the safety of both healthcare staff and patients. The government has earlier allocated $4.7 billion from the NT Epidemic Fund to provide additional resources for the HA in tackling the epidemic, in particular for ensuring sufficient support and protection for frontline healthcare staff. In the end of September, the government sought approval from the Finance Committee of the Legislative Council for an additional allocation of $3.44 billion for the HA to establish and operate community treatment facility and temporary hospital, and to sustain its existing anti-epidemic efforts and support for frontline healthcare staff. With the additional allocation, the HA has endeavored to procure protective equipment from frontline staff and provide all necessary service and manpower support. Non-emergency services have also been adjusted to focus resources on fighting the epidemic. The HA has all along attached importance to communication with staff so as to enhance mutual understanding and trust and provide them with the necessary support. The HA understands the worries of frontline staff about COVID-19 epidemic and their concerns over work arrangements. Since the early stage of the epidemic, the HA has proactively addressed staff concerns expressed on various platforms, such as the media and the social media. The HA has also set up a 24-hour hotline to answer their queries. Lastly, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank once again the HA staff who have remained dedicated to their duties to maintain public hospital services. The HA will continue to maintain communication with the staff members and unions, address the concerns and provide appropriate support for frontline staff so as to keep up the concerted efforts to combat the epidemic in the interests of patients. Thank you, Mr. President. Yes, Ms. Dari Lee. Mr. President, during the industrial action, as the Secretary mentioned just now, the hospital cluster services had to reduce their non-emergency services or elective surgeries by 50% and quotas for patients with episodic illnesses by 25%. For chronic patients, PT/OT services, they have to be cut by 50%. Now, Mr. President, we're all concerned about the welfare of patients. It is the HA as well as the government's duty to allow patients to receive treatment as soon as possible. Now, I understand during the industrial action period, non-emergency services or non-emergency surgeries and follow-up appointments have had to be delayed. So, Secretary, Can you tell us what plan do you have in catching up with this delay so that patients can receive the treatment they need as soon as possible? Can you provide a reply in writing? Because many patients have been affected. And what are the immediate measures implemented and also the impact? Secretary. Mr. President, as Ms. Starry Lee mentioned, in relation to the industrial action in which HA staff were absent from duty, it was very undesirable that the hospital services were interrupted. But after the epidemic situation had been stabilized, redeployment of manpower could allow for some services to be resumed, and at the moment, these services have indeed been resumed. As for postponement of follow-up appointments and the backlog of cases, in fact, quite some time ago, the HA began a scheme, and that is, with the help of public-private collaboration, urgent cases or patients requiring different treatments or diagnoses could take this approach, as well as some medical procedures and surgeries. They've all been dealt with under the public-private partnership model. With the ebbing of the epidemic, manpower deployment can be put in place for staff members to continue to provide the original scheduled services. I understand at the same time, the HA has been hiring part-time staff, and some staff members of the HA have also been working overtime to provide these services to catch up with the delay. We'll continue to monitor the overall situation so that with additional manpower resources, more things can be done. In fact, since July, more nurses and doctors have joined the HA. Part-time staff have been recruited, and together with the public-private partnership, we can clear the backlog. Your question hasn't been answered. Well, in fact, that's a really vague answer from the Secretary. She hasn't answered whether a supplementary reply can be provided in writing, because it is unacceptable for so many patients to wait so long. Secretary, yes, of course, we can provide a written response. We will invite the HA to set out the situation of delays and the latest situation. Mr. Chen Kim-Paul. I'd also like to thank HA staff who have remained dedicated to their service, and also healthcare professionals who had volunteered services during the epidemic. Well, for healthcare professionals, they have our respect because they are meant to be here to save lives. Around the world, we see different problems, shortage of personal protective equipment, and even healthcare professionals catching the virus and having passed away. And yet, we haven't seen any industrial actions around the world from the healthcare sector. Is there anything you can put in place to make sure we won't be threatened by such industrial actions? Secretary, during the 3rd to the 7th of February, an industrial action was staged. It was totally undesirable. As I mentioned in the main reply, the healthcare profession is very important, and the primary principle is to save the lives of patients and consider the welfare of patients, and nothing should be allowed to affect their duty and the patients. This has all along been the professionalism and ethics of the healthcare profession, as well as expectation of society and the general public for them. So I believe in this incident, the hospital authority would consider the mechanism in general. The HA will handle this incident, and at the same time, the HA will also prevent a repeat of such incidents and also draw up responsive measures. Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Mr. President. Well, like Ms. Sari Lee and Mr. Chen Kin Po said, we appreciate that there are so many good healthcare professionals in Hong Kong. But then when it comes to fighting a battle, it's not just about exhausting the enemy's resources. It's about, for example, firing bullets and pouring poison on them. Well, this question is exactly stems from what happened last year during the Black Riot, that industrial actions were staged due to political reasons, and that members of the public are deterred from using the services which have been infiltrated, so to speak, with poison. So is there anything that can be done to boost the public's confidence in the public healthcare system so that any member of the public would not be subject to unfair treatment in public hospitals? It's just like members sitting here. I feel deterred from, you know, using the public hospital services. I don't care about the follow-up appointments cancelled or delayed because I won't be going to a public hospital anyway, not even the police officers. Secretary, regarding the code of conduct, professionalism of HA staff and their conduct whilst at work, the HA has always been very concerned, and there are also human resources regulations and code of conduct setting out rules, and the HA also follow up on complaints. During the social incidents happening, there were a lot of information circulating and on the internet, and the HA has been taking a very serious stance in handling complaints. Now, in terms of salvaging the public's confidence or boosting the public's confidence in public hospitals, the HA has this responsibility. And on this occasion, the HA inquired with members of staff who have been absent from duty, and this is an ongoing exercise. Mr. Tommy Jung. Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, I thank the frontline staff of HA for their hard work during the epidemic. But then the problem is this. We need to deal with the minority. Over the years, the Liberal Party has been putting forward this idea to you, Secretary, not just during the epidemic, but before that. Well, the HA indeed could recruit overseas doctors to work in public hospitals. But then the number is really so insignificant. Even after we changed the rules a few years ago, that didn't help the situation. That's because after their contract has come to an end, they have no idea about their prospect, whether they can stay on. Now that we've all along had a shortage of doctors and healthcare professionals, especially, and the problem is even more apparent during the epidemic, can you make sure that some medical doctors would not dominate the medical council and get in the way of allowing overseas doctors to be recruited to provide services, the necessary services to the public? Mr. Tommy Chung's question is not really speaking to the subject. Secretary, would you like to answer anyway? Mr. President, just to give some information to Mr. Tommy Chung about the manpower of doctors and also our communication with the hospital authority. On the one hand, we are concerned about the shortage of doctors as well, and we've strived to communicate with the Medical Council of Hong Kong and also the other professional body comprising doctors in Hong Kong to improve the whole mechanism of allowing overseas doctors to return to Hong Kong and serve our hospitals. Now, of course, in relation to the different disciplines of medicine, the colleges impose different requirements on these specialists who would like to return to Hong Kong to work. Now, in relation to improvements to the system, i.e. relaxation of certain restrictions, they are looking into these measures so that on the one hand, we can maintain the proper standard for the medical profession whilst removing obstacles for overseas doctors who would like to practice in Hong Kong. So in relation to the number of overseas doctors working in hospital authority, if we take a look at the figure, well, if they work in the HA or the Department of Health or the two universities, they are exempted from the examination. So this is something that we're working on to lift the restriction. And in fact, we've been yielding results. The number of overseas doctors returning to Hong Kong to practice have been on the rise, and we'll continue to liaise with the hospital authority, and we'll also continue to improve the system to encourage and attract more overseas doctors to come and serve in public hospitals. Mr. Abraham Shek, now that we have a new order in the Legislative Council, now, Secretary, you can't give us a perfunctory reply. I don't think you've answered the questions. I think the crux of the question is how you're going to deal with staff of HA who participated in the industrial action. You can't just try to pull wool over our eyes. Now, you say it's a fair, reasonable, lawful manner, but that can't be the case. Because it may not be reasonable whilst it is lawful on the one hand. So you need to tell us whether you will just reprimand them or give them some heavy punishment. So you need to really ask specific questions and answer these specific questions. Any response from the secretary? Well, the HA is the employer, and the HA has all along been handling this employment relations issue. Now, in early October, the hospital authority issued letters to these staff members, and this is just a start. Of course, after receiving their replies, the HA will proceed to the next step. And let me reiterate that the HA has been taking a very serious stance in handling these matters. Government bills. Resumption of second reading debate. The Secretary for Transport and